This is Patrick Russell. I'm interviewing Brodie Hand for the first time. This interview is taking place on November the 5th, 2016. We're in Charleston, South Carolina. This interview is being conducted by the Making History Project. Why don't you tell me, Brodie, how this all started? Where were you born?
Beg your pardon, I didn't understand the question.
Where were you born?
I was born in Trinity, Texas.
All right. When was that?
April 8, 1920.
Okay, and how big is Trinity, Texas?
Oh, it was at that time probably 500 people.
And what is Trinity, Texas known for?
At that time, it was probably farming and fishing because it's on the Trinity River.
Okay.
And that's where the people located. And that time of the year, boats could go up the Trinity, all the way up to the Trinity River. There was locks in the river just north of the city of Trinity.
How big was your family?
Well, at that time, I had two brothers, Bill and Carol, and of course, my mother and father.
And what were you doing before the war? Were you in school?
Before the war? We moved from Trinity in 24. And we moved into Anahuac, Texas. At that time, the only way you could get to Anahuac was go to Galveston, catch a boat from Galveston to Anahuac. There was no roads or in leading in and out. It was just open prairie. No fences to keep you from going any which way you wanted to go. But the closest town at that time was Devers, or Liberty, Texas. And we went by boat to get there. My grandfather lived in Double By, they called it, which was just north of Anahuac and between Anahuac and Galveston. So that's why we probably ended up there. Although my brother had a stroke, or he had polio, and he was being treated in Houston. So actually I was told by my mother and father that the reason we went to Anahuac was to be closer to Houston. Although it was a lot harder to get to Houston from Anahuac than it was from Trinity to Houston.
Okay. And so when the war started in 1941, what were you doing?
I had finished high school in 39. And I was working part-time at that time. The oil boom came into what was later known as Monroe City. They wanted to locate in Anahuac. And at that time, Humble Oil Company, which turned into Exxon, was looking for a place to build a little colony of workers. Well, they couldn't get satisfied out of Anahuac, so they moved out to the oil field, which was in Monroe City, later named. And that's where we worked at oil field labor at different times. And then we saved enough money, a friend of mine, Jack Caves, to go to college. And I had a scholarship in football or in track, which also helped me get in school. Well, to get to college, you had to go 200 or 300 miles to get into a college. All the way you could go was thumb ride or walk part of the way and get there. At that time, at 39 and 40, I went to college Marshall at 41 and 42. I had spent time in ROTC and had been 3 years in it, and I also had passed the entrance exam that they required. So when I got notice from the government to peer into get in service, well, I was close to Shreveport, Louisiana, so I thumbed a ride over to Shreveport and took the examination, and actually I failed because my eyes were too bad. I couldn't believe it that I laid it on to being studying too much because I wasn't that good a student to begin with. But anyway, that was where I really got upset about not getting into service, because I would have been a commissioned officer there, and went home, and my father was on the board, and we, all us boys, thought we better get into service first, because we needed to make an example of the rest of the men that had to go. But I went to Houston and volunteered. As I walked upstairs to get interviewed, I saw a big sign, "Join the Paratroopers," and that's what made my mind up. I said, well, if I'm going to be in the Army, I want to be in the best. So I signed up for the Paratroopers.
And when was that? You remember the year?
That was in October of 42.
All right, and then you enlisted into the Paratroopers, and did you end up going to Fort Benning? Where did you go for training?
I went to San Antonio, the first stop, and being in Texas, that's where the big Army bases were, in San Antonio. And being as I had the training all right, and I was put in charge of the group that was going to join the Paratroopers. We went on the train. The first stop was Houston. The boys jumped up and they said, well, we're going to go get in the telephones and call home. I said, oh, no, we better stay on this on this train. And they went on in anyway, but they got back in plenty of time because the train was held up anyway. And we went on to New Orleans. New Orleans, we were on a troop train. Before we got there, they were serving breakfast. And we decided half of us would go eat with the troop train because we didn't have any place to eat on our organization at that time. And half of us got up to the troop train, and they divided the train. They dropped half of the train back on the tracks, and half of it went with the troop train. So there we were in New Orleans, nowhere to go, nothing to do. We got back and stayed the night. I had to send in a telegram that's showing why we weren't on time and why we would miss the trains and all. And from there on, we got all of us got together that night because they were staying all at the Red Cross place. And we was able to go on to Blanding, Florida. And that's where the 82nd was started. It was in Blanding. And we were all recruits that had ever been in anything and in all. And that's where we started.
And how was basic training? Was it hard?
At that time, I had played basketball a couple of years in college and run track. I was in good shape. And at that time, I didn't drink as much as later on. And training really wasn't that hard for me. A lot of the troopers had not run, had not lived in the places where they could run or where they could camp out at night and do things like we had in South Texas. So I was way ahead not only in years, but in experience that I automatically had. And what else would be qualified but to be of age? And they had my records, and they asked me to fall in a group of men and march them off and back and forth, and which I did. But the officers in charge decided that I didn't have the commanding voice that sergeant or training would have, and so I stayed a PFC.
And what specialty did you have in the airborne? Did you have one?
Pardon?
What specialty did you have in the airborne?
Specialties? Really, wasn't a great deal of training, mostly running and exercises, and we had the standard equipment that probably was on every Air Force base or Army base at the time, climbing walls and going under machine gun fire and all those kind of things that everyone took. But we had a 26-mile hike to qualify. At that time, the Japanese held the record on a 26-mile hike. And some officer decided that the American people could do just as well as the Japanese. So that's what we did. We had that 26 miles. And that was one of the things that you had to do and make without falling out, full field pack, to stay in the paratroopers, to make that. And we all did, of course, to make it.
Were you involved in demolitions?
I wasn't more than we had demolition officers come down and give us lectures and show us demolition equipment And as far as getting any actual training at that time, I did not get anything out of just watching and then seeing and what would happen and what primer card was and how bad TNT was and CD, which was a putty type demolition that you could raise a piece off and light it with a match and cook your meal over it. It had to have a booster to really explode and do any damage. So we did pick up a little information there.
What weapons were you qualified to use as an airborne paratrooper?
I had mostly at that time the O3, which was a single shot, bolt action, 30-06 at that time. Later, we got the M1, and of course they were all packed in the car and call scene in some kind of jelly type packing, and we had to boil the belts and bowls out and get rid of all the grease and all. And later on, after probably a year or more, I was promoted up to a corporal, and it called for a Thompson submachine gun, which I carried, and which was really a proper gun, or better than a rifle, at close quarters, which actually we were at all of our firing and against enemy action was close. So actually my Thompson was a beautiful thing to have along.
And there came a time where you deployed overseas, right?
Beg pardon?
There came a time where you deployed overseas.
Overseas?
When was that?
That was in Christmas of 43, yeah. And I was at that time having problems with having flu and then other things that schoolboys did and had. And I became sick in Camp Shanks, New York. And you do not go on medical call when you're ready to go overseas. And so I couldn't go to the medics. I had to bear it out. And I told the company commander, Milam, that I was sick and I had the flu or something. He said, well, there's nothing we can do about it, just go ahead. And it makes you so weak that everybody had, in our group, had got on the ship before I got there. I had to drag my A bag, B bag with me. And when I got there, well, the captain was waiting there. He says, hey, let's see, you made it. I said, yes, sir, I'm going to make it. He said, well, the Navy will take your equipment and you go on up to the top deck to the hospital ship. So I went overseas in the hospital bed, and at that time, Captain was the Thompson was a medical doctor at that time, and so at all you could get was sulfur drug. We made it in 10 days to Belfast, Ireland. We docked there, and they put me in a ambulance, took me to the hospital in Belfast. I stayed in the hospital 3 weeks, 2 weeks, and I was discharged, and I told the doctor I was going to be called on to do a lot of running and exercise, being as we were paratroopers. And he says, well, you'll never do it. And I said, well, if I can get enough exercise while I'm in the hospital, I'll make it. He said, well, I'll carry you over for another week then before you can go back to your company. So that's what we did. I stayed an extra week, and I run every day and try to get back in shape. When I got to the company, First Sergeant was there to meet, of course, and that was Funk, Sergeant Funk, and he checked me in. He said, where it goes, says, now, we're going on the run in tomorrow morning, and he says, you can't keep up, I'm sure. And I said, well, I might be able to, I don't know. I wonder how far you're going to run. And so we took off the next day, and he told me, he said, well, when you get played out, just sit down on the side of the road, wait. And that's what I did. Set the road down. When they came back by, I jumped in the line again, and they, the boys all right, told me, I said, don't get in line with me. You laid out too long. So that gave me a razzing about being out. But anyway, from then on, I made it all right. I didn't have any problem with being on.
And then you did some training while, did you go to England? Did you make it to England?
Made what, sir?
Did you, from Belfast, did you eventually go to England?
Belfast, we went to Ireland. I had, we trained there in Ireland for, seemed to me like a month or maybe more. And we had a good time there because we did a little, very little exercise, was mostly at all, and it was any that way. So from Ireland, we made a short stop in Scotland on the way, and then we went on into England. And we went right to our camp in Nottingham. And, of course, that was an enclosed castle with a brick wall all the way around it, where you couldn't get out, you couldn't go any place. So we were pretty well confined there, except for our ingenuity of getting out, which always a good soldier had lots of that. You can't keep a good man down. So at night we slip out the back and crawl over the wall and go to town and drink beer and have a good time. I got into a young lady there at Nottingham, and we become good friends because I had, first night, had all the money we could carry around with us, and I gave her a pound note. I didn't know how much money a pound note was. And the next night I got out again, and she met me with a handful of money. I said, what in the world's that? She said, well, you just don't know how much money you gave me when I gave a pound note. I thought, well, that'd get her home. But she said, oh, that was way too much money. From then on, we would meet at the pub, and she would have the beer bought and have it on the table waiting for me. So I thought, well, that's the girl for me. So we enjoyed drinking beer every night that I could slip off and get in there. And, of course, she knew what time I was coming and all. And the pubs in England were an institution. They're owned by the government, and they are a family affair. Everybody goes to the pub, women, children, all. And even the dogs are welcome. And everybody has a good time. And we sang little ditties and all of it and all. Let me give you a little one. In Ireland, the streets are filled with glass. And every time a young lassie passed by, you could see her little rinky-dinky, pop-a-linky. If you think I lie, come to me with Belcher Town and see the same as I. Now there goes on more verses, and I have to say I forgot the other verses. I can't kill them. But we enjoyed being in the pubs in England. We did.
All right. And then there came a point where we have D-Day.
D-Day.
Right. And
we moved up two or three days ahead of time. So that was probably around the 1st or 2nd of June when we got on the bus and moved us up to the airfield. And of course, you know that D-Day was supposed to be the 5th, but the weather was so bad that Eisenhower had to call it off. So we went to 6. But we had a real good time waiting there because we stole all of the Air Corps bicycles and rode around and got out and got beer and all we wanted and came back in and all, which was not known at that time that you could do that. But a paratrooper always figured no meant after you try it out and see if it's no. So that was the way we got by with a lot of stuff that we did. I remember coming home one time on furlough, stopped in Houston. We was having a wonderful time dancing, and I had two girls, one on each arm, and the MPs walked up to us and says, soldier, how about your pass? Well, you got a pass? I says, you've been notified a paratrooper is over the hill? No. I said, well, then after the fight is over, then you can see my pass. He said, oh, you drunkard, get on down the road. Yeah. So we didn't do anything. Well, you know, BS gets you further in this army than anything else. They say ES is good, but it's not better than BS. You know what that stands for.
All right, so take me to the night of June 5th.
Sir.
Or the morning of June 6th. You had to load up and go somewhere, right?
go
on the morning of June 6th.
I didn't understand.
For June 6th, did you participate in the D-Day drop?
We were dropped in, it was a terrible situation. The fog had settled down over our drop zone, you might say, and the C-47s which we were jumping scattered. Now, they ordinarily fly in triangles of three, and we were on the outside of the triangle of the third ship, and so each plane pulled off to the side, and we were later found out we were 18 miles off the drop zone, which is just a second or two in an airplane to ride. He wasn't that bad off, but at least it put us way out. It took us most of scattered were out in trees and forth, and Lieutenant Bell and part of the jump situation fell in a little town, and they were killed, and the group I was with was out of town, and I got the four of the troopers together, and we started back. Of course, everybody said, well, which way we got to go? I told them, I said, well, we're going the way the airplanes went. That's home. They were headed home. And I said, that'll take us to the beach, and we can find out then where everybody else is. So that's what we did. We started out that way and headed with them.
And you were in Company C of the 508 at that
yes,
point.
Yes, yeah.
All right. And you were left with, when you landed, you only found four of your group.
Well, we were scattered out. Of course, Milan broke his leg at a jump in England, and Captain Silver was our company commander of C Company at that time. And so our group was supposed to have been on the Meredith River, and here we ended up. Took us 3 days or more to get to the Doe River, which was on the other side of the river. And we couldn't get across. At that time, they'd flooded that whole country in there, and which grass and all was growing in. We didn't know just where the channel was, but to us standing there looking at the river, it looked 200 and 300 feet wide, and couldn't figure on swimming that far and getting our equipment with us or anything else. So a group got together, and we stayed there, and a couple of the officers was with other ones that got there ahead of us, and they were in the same house. And Lieutenant Lavender was a C Company officer, and we had another Lieutenant Lavelle. He wasn't a C Company man at all. But anyway, it was mixed up group. They had not only mixed up the planes with different sections, but different planes had crossed back and forth, and you might be with 504 group, or you might be with 101st, which was supposed to be down close to the beach. and our job was further out. But at that time, I was divination. Captain Silver came by and asked me if I'd be a demolition sergeant, and I told him, well, I'd never studied it. And he said, well, I'm going to send you to the English school there, and you'll get 3 days of training. So that's what I did there. And so when I jumped, demolition equipment and all at the place to blow a bridge on the Doe River. And of course, when you jump into combat, you have a job to do. No matter what officer or what non-com tells you otherwise, you tell him your job comes first. And that's what happens. You can tell any officer, and he'll admit it, that you have a job to do, you go ahead. You don't stay with him because he wants you to do. So we went on till we got to the bridge there on the Doe River.
That was your mission?
That was our mission. We didn't know which bridge, but it was a bridge, so that was it. Okay.
So what did you do at that bridge? What happened?
We had not joined the group at that time. We got there ahead of them, and we went up at night and put the demolitions, implanted them, and took us all a big part of the night to do that, and put demolition wires and wired up with primer card and our firing TNT and all together. It would have been a good blow. And then we went back before daylight, and by then is when we run into the officers in the other group, and they wanted to know that. And we were getting, our group was getting food from French people at night. We'd run out of food by then. And so one of the men could speak a little French. He went in to get the food lined up and get that. And lo and behold, here comes the German walking down the road. And there was a stone wall that we were behind waiting. And I just stepped out with my Thompson and told him, hands up and come on, let's go. And I put him behind the wall and told the other men there to tie him up with a rope or wire or anything they could get their hands on. And later, another one came by, and we ended up with 3 POWs there of the Germans. So we got our food together, we went on to the main group, and I turned him over to Lieutenant Lavender. He says, well, go out and take them care of them. And I told him, no, sir, I can't shoot a man down. He's just standing there because he's surrounded. He said, well, in that case, I guess we'll have to carry him with us. I said, well, let's do that, then, unless you want to go out and shoot him. And so we went on. And we got up close to the bridge the next night. He asked me to take us, the group, up to the bridge. Maybe we could get across. So we got up close to the bridge and stayed at another French house. And he set troopers out on the roads to guard for the night. And made it through the night all right, but next day the Germans was walking down the road and one of the men took a shot at him, and they didn't kill all of them. They said there was two or three of them, but they got away, one of them did. And so that wasn't long till the Germans advanced on us. And of course, when they came, they had a tank destroyer or a tank, or I think it was mostly an old French cannon and all. It was stripped down model. It wasn't a complete tank. But anyway, it was enough to blow that French hut apart that was made out of rock and bricks and all. And we didn't last long. We fired all, of course, most of the ammunition was 03 and 45s, and that's all we had. And so the Germans that we had captured asked and hollered to the German officer that we wanted to give up. So Lieutenant Lavender made the arrangements for us to give up, and the Germans quit firing and quit. They'd killed a few, but not too many. We'd got down on the floors, you know, below the bricks and below the concrete and all that. We weren't all that many killed. And took us guards and marched us to a small village right next to the bridge, and put us in a barn-like structure that had no windows or anything in it, no way of getting out. So they locked us up, but the next day we marched out of there and headed, of course, out of France towards Germany.
So at that point you became a prisoner of war. And did you ended the war as a prisoner of war, correct?
No, you're not a prisoner of war until you are classified and notified, and you get a tag, 73D5 was my German number. And that, until then, you're missing in action. Just what the Americans send to your home, missing in action. So actually, if you're going to escape, that is the time to try to get out, is while before you're POW. And from then on, they have more control over you and better situations than before you're considered a POW.
Okay. And so where did they take you next?
Well, I was in so many different camps. When we first got back, I was able to name a whole lot of them. I think there was probably 8 or 9 or 10 or more. The Germans had thousands of prisoners of war camps. They had camps for the Jewish people, had camps for the friendly people that we call the different names too, and they had prisoner of war camps for officers. Certain grade officers stayed in a certain grade camps and so forth. And so you couldn't very well go through any town in France or Germany or anywhere else that the Germans had taken over without a camp of some sort being there. They had them by the thousands. They had them for women. They had them for the young boys that was in the military that weren't old enough to get into service, but they were getting training. And they had just all over. They were organized. I'll say that for the Germans. They were well organized. They knew how to carry on a war.
When you first got captured, was that a real terrifying moment?
First got captured, beg pardon?
When you first got captured, was that a real terrifying moment for you?
I don't think so. It wasn't sudden. It was over a period of time. We knew we couldn't hold out. We knew we were running out of ammunition. And it was not really, we didn't understand what being a prisoner was going to be like. And we didn't hate it so much, you know. We were disappointed. There were troopers crying. There were troopers cussing. There was troopers of all type and all that each individual had to accept it to himself the way he felt.
Were you ever worried that the Germans wouldn't treat you as nice as you treated those three that you captured?
We actually worried after we'd been a prisoner a few weeks or months that the Americans or the English would catch us on the road or catch us in a railroad station or a church or somewhere and bombing us, killing us off. At one time we were what they called 40 and 8, or 40 prisoners and 8 horses was in those old boxcars. And of course they had us in there by 60, more or less. And the only way you could get any rest was get your buddy to stand up, and where we all were standing and packed in there, and you'd sit down and get between his legs and sit there, and he'd take up your room in his room, and you could get a rest. And then after you rest, well, you came out from under his legs, and he got in your legs and sat down, and that was the way we made it along. Let's see. We got shot up one time, C-47s, and the old, I can't think of the name of the airplane now, came by after he shot us up, and we got out. Of course, we were locked in. The Germans had to turn us out. And everybody took their shirt off and put POW, made it a sign out of it on the ground there so that the Americans recognized we were prisoners of war. But that was always a problem from then on. You recognized the Americans or the English was your enemy as bad as the Germans were.
Did you receive any awards or medals for your service?
While I was a prisoner?
No. Well, before that?
No, I had a, in training in San Antonio at ROTC, I tied for second place with the rifle range, and I had a medal that I could wore all good training in the paratroopers, and I wouldn't do it because I probably had to fight everybody in the whole company to do it. But anyway, that was the only medal I received before the war was over.
Okay. What about a Purple Heart?
Oh, yes. Later, was able to get a Purple Heart for the wound I received the morning that the guard shot me. And it was a minor wound. And I was able to, one of the boys took his kid out and patched me up. And so it wasn't a big problem. But I received that. And then I received a Purple Heart for the Russians bombing us one day. And actually, it was not shrapnel from the bomb. It was shrapnel from the rocks and blue and pepper would be good with it. And that was also a bomb.
And you were captured in June of 44?
Yes.
And then how long until you were liberated?
All right. 10 days, 10th hour, and 10 minutes. I had everything was 10, 10, 10, 10. It was 11, almost 11 months that I was a prisoner of war. Yeah.
And you went, you served in a coal mine in Czechoslovakia?
Yes.
Okay.
Of course, we worked in different things as we went back through France. And in Germany, we did other jobs. And so, actually, at the end of the war, you might say, we ended up, the Americans had pressed us back. As they advanced, we went back further. So we knew we were winning a war. And I was working in a coal mine with a Czech. And he was a very nice fellow. He helped me a lot. And it caved in on me one night. And I was very lucky. I was by my cart that I had to fill with coal. And before you came up, you filled that cart up with coal before you could come up. So the cart really saved me from getting crushed. But I did get banged up pretty bad. And that's where the boys held me on the table, and the German doctor opened the wounds and all, and they had to hold me on the table to do it. And that was all. No medicine, no pain pills or anything. In fact, they had nothing but white paper that they used for wrapping wounds with and all. And that's what I had there for probably 2 or 3 weeks of that. And actually, it was getting worse. It was spreading, and all the doctor could do was freeze dizzy, the leg, and mop it out and wrap it up. So the Russians were getting awful close to us in Falkenau, Czechoslovakia. And the company commander, which was very good to us at that time, said he was going to send me to the German hospital. So he named a German guard to go with me and take me to Duisburg Hospital. In the meantime, the boys had decided that wasn't going to work because we were burying a soldier, and I was working night shift, and I was able to go with the group that buried the soldier that died. The next day, they wanted to take off and go to the funeral. Well, they did get out of bed. They lay there, they told Germans they weren't going to work that day. And so the Germans hollered, "Rush, rush, rush." And then nobody wanted to get up and go. So the German guard just shot one out of the bed. That settled. There was no striking as a POW. They found out right quick you worked, whether you wanted to or not. But we was also able to then bury him. And we took him up the hill, and we buried him by the other men. And later on, I was talking to different people, and I notified them that I knew where there was two soldiers, POWs, located, if they wanted to check it out and see if they had anybody else had notified them, because they were very interesting in trying to get men together that were killed, and nobody knew where they were or anything. And of course, they're still doing that. That's a good program that they are trying to return everybody to their family. And I told them where we were and where this little cemetery was from the town. And he said, "Well, we'll look into it." And I never knew whether or not they ever found out that nobody notified me that they had or they hadn't. Or I'm sure they did, though. I'm sure somebody else had already told them about it before I did.
What was the name of the town?
Falkenau. Of course, the Germans changed to every city. And it made a terrible situation trying to find. I had a brother that taught school, and at the time he was teaching school in Germany, the American students. And I asked him, I told him, I said, "I'd like to go over there some year and try to find the old camp." And we got as far as Pilsen, Czechoslovakia, and the Czechs were just a little bit rowdy on whether they were German sympathizers or whether they were American sympathizers. And we could not get a we did get, maybe that was a better word, where Falconel was. And, of course, later on we understood and found out that they had changed the name of the town, and it wasn't Falconel at all. It was some other name they changed it to. I don't remember now. But I did get to go back to the camp.
And generally, how did the Germans treat the prisoners of war? Did you see a difference between Americans and other types of people, or not?
The Germans are wonderful organization people. Even their own people are organized. Of course, we were work groups, but as our president says, the black people did not associate with the black people, with the whites. Now, at that time in 36 and 30 and 40s, black people in Texas were niggers, and that's what they always reminded us of, that we were super white people, that we were not to be with the Czech people or get with anybody else. That was, of course, to keep us from trying to escape and see through the history of the German people, that they were so organized that they had camps for every different organization. Jews, the queer people, the officers were in different camps, sick people were, everybody had camps for thousands of camps in the town.
And outside of treating you like a worker, did they treat you any differently being an American soldier or even a paratrooper? Did you notice anything in that regard?
The American soldiers? I say we did not have the training. The Germans were wonderful soldiers. They had been through numbers of wars, and when they took the Polish over and took the Czechs over, and they were true soldiers, better soldiers than the Americans were, because we had no experience, no idea of what was going to happen or when it happened or how it happened at all. And they were true soldiers.
Did you see any Russian POWs?
Oh, yes.
Tell me about that.
The Russians did not sign the Red Cross and the citizens of Germany did not sign up for the Red Cross situation. The Germans accepted the wartime situation of a Red Cross, and the Americans were treated real good compared to the Russians. The Russians were captured by the thousands. They were there in the large camps where everybody met different situations, and they were groups peeled off to go to this place or go to somewhere else and work, or go somewhere and work in the hospitals or do something else. The Russians were there by the thousand. I got to be a friend of a Russian. We happened to meet there at the barbed wire fence. They were fenced off different from us. And he made me a cigarette case holder that would hold two or three packs of cigarettes out of a canteen that he had found and picked up. And he wanted to sell it to me for cigarettes or anything he could get, of course. And I gave him cigarettes for it, and I brought it home with me from that Russian. But they were slept outside. They did have a great deal of no Red Cross parcels, nothing but what the Germans wanted to give them, and that was a very little soup, mostly water. We called it dandelion soup, and that's what they made of it.
Have you heard of the phrase war is hell?
Did a what?
Have you heard of the phrase war is hell? Have you heard that phrase?
Can't understand it.
Oh. Have you heard the phrase war is hell?
Holland.
No. That war is hell. Have you heard that phrase?
Oh. Well, war is hell, but there's other things that could be classified as more than war is hell. It's hell to be even here in the States at different times, and you can make it your hell, or you can make it that you will control yourself, and it won't be hell. There was troopers that were confined that had, over a period of time, decided that their mother and father had passed away. He decided, this one man, that it was no longer any reason for him to live because his mother and father were dead. We tried to talk him out of that notion, but we couldn't do it. We tried. He held that he was going to join him. He ran and jumped on the fence, and the Germans killed him. So what is hell? You make it whatever you want to. And not get into a religious pilgrim.
As a result of your experience, did you bring any type of lasting effects back home?
When I got home, what happened to me? One day I was a prisoner of war. It was 3 days before Patton could get back and get the word out and send the trucks to pick us up. So a Catholic priest was rolling a little wagon down the road with nothing but unleavened bread and wine. We ate all of the bread, a can of bread, and drank that wine and got pleased and re-drunk. We stayed drunk for 3 days waiting on the trucks to come pick us up. They picked us up and took us to the first airfield. And at that time, I had a friend of mine who was a lieutenant with Patton's group that had been on the path that Patton had sent a group to get his son-in-law and brother-in-law out of a prison. If you read that part, well, you remember that. And he got captured. This group and this lieutenant stayed in my cabin. I was in charge of the little cabin outside of the hospital. And, of course, I put him by the window where there wasn't nobody else wanted to stay. Because when they started bombing Nuremberg, that window would not stay closed. You jumped and got the doors and the windows wide open, and then you'd run and jumped into the slit trench and hid. So I got back at him a little bit, and he was a nice fella. He didn't mind it. And he didn't try to pull a rank on me, which would have made any difference anyway, because I'd have done whatever I wanted to. But we stopped, got out, waited for the plane. And then, of course, it's always hurry up and wait. And he and I sat down in the cook shack. And the cook says, hey, you fellas want something to eat? And we told him, well, you might have right, we want something to eat. He says, well, I can't do anything better than donuts. And I can give you plenty of milk and donuts. So he cooked us up some donuts and milk. And we were sitting there, just the two of us, eating donuts and drinking milk. And the airplane pilot comes and says, well, we're time to go. We're ready to go. And I told him, well, I looked at the lieutenant, and he looked at me, and he says, go ahead and go then. If you want to go, we're going to stay here. So we did. We sat there and let him go, and we caught the next plane out. So then we flew into Paris. In Paris hospital, every 3 hours, they gave me a shot of penicillin. At that time, penicillin was a new medicine that hit the block. Boy, everybody was bragging about what a wonderful medicine, and it was a medicine of wonder. And I had my butt so sore from every three hours again. They didn't even have to wake us up. They just popped it to us whether we wanted to do it or not. They came by after a few days and wanted to know we had a chance. And, of course, they were talking to the officer. Flying back to the United States or going down and staying and waiting to get a ship. And the officer looked at me and says, you want to fly back? I said, yes, sir. I said, boy, I've had enough of this. And well, he says, okay. He says, sign us both up. We'll fly back. So we flew. They had hammocks strung in the airplane, and we were in PJs and jackets, coats, robes, and we went to Greenland, and landed, and refueled, and flew into New York. And we stayed a couple of nights in New York, and then he moved on out to the officer's quarters, and I lost him then, and I wished I'd have got his address and all many a time, and I'm sure he thought so too, maybe. We flew then into Memphis or Atlanta. I think at that time we stopped at Atlanta. And from Atlanta, we flew to San Antonio. And it happens to, when you leave Louisiana, New Orleans, you fly right over Anahuac. And I walked up to the pilot. I said, if you got a parachute, I'll be home in 30 minutes. He says, what? I says, yeah. I says, I'll get home in 30 minutes. And he laughed. I said, he didn't know I was in a paratrooper. And so we flew on into San Antonio. We were still in our bathrobe, PJs. Landed. Some lieutenant told a young enlisted man to put us in the truck, take us to the medics. That was fine with us. We got the trucks, bus, and he took us to one part of San Antonio's field. Stop. He says, I can't carry you any further. I got orders to stay on this road and not get off of this road, that you'll have to walk down to the medics, which was two or three blocks down there. And I told him, I says, now, I want you to know something. We are not on sick leave. We are returning veterans from prisons and from command posts and from veterans of combat. We want to go to the doctor. He said, well, I can't do it. And I was right behind him. I reached over the dress and grabbed it around the neck with a leg halt. And I says, you son of a bitch. You gonna take us to the medics, whether you want to or not. He says, well, I'll catch hell. I said, yeah, you're going to have a broken neck, too, when you catch hell, because I'm going to break your damn neck if you don't take me to the medics. So that's what he did. They turned around and took us to the medic. I says, now, when you check in, you tell whoever your officer is that a rank higher than he is ordered me to take you off. I said, well, that suits me fine. You just tell him whatever you want to. But we were there at the medics and all. That was a problem. A week and less, or 2 weeks, we had left a prisoner of war camp where we were ordered to do this, that, and the other. And here we get back to Texas, and they wouldn't even carry us to the medics. I said, that was a big change, and we couldn't understand it. I was mad at the Army, mad at everybody in control, and everybody that was in San Antonio. They took us to the hospital, Fort Sam. They put a guard by my bed because they thought I was radical, thought I was out of my head or was prone to do something wrong, and I wasn't. It was just that I couldn't understand why we were treated worse than the damn Germans were treating us at that time. And that was a hello, goodbye to the service right there in San Antonio.
And after you got out of the service, did you have any problems as a result of your service in the war?
We stayed in the hospital in San Antonio till all my wounds were healed, and I talked to the different socials, the POWs weren't organized at that time, but the American Red Cross was Salvation Army, and the of course the Army officers quizzed us as to where we had been, what we had done, what we got a history there. I got my medical discharge from the hospital, one pair of shoes and one suit of clothes, and the ruptured duct. You know what the ruptured duct was? That showed that you'd been discharged from the service. It's a little pin that you could wear. We all called it the ruptured duct. I went to town. Of course, we had to walk town. At that time, Fort Sam Houston was way out of San Antonio. Walked to town, and I found a bar that would take my ruptured duct and give me drinks as long as I could drink. So my ruptured duct did a good job. We drank that night. I live approximately 300 miles from San Antonio. Where in the hell was I going to get home? Sticky thumb out and ride. It took me 2 days and a whole bunch of pubs and beer joints and all to get home. Finally, a couple of girls come by in an old dilapidated, and we loaded it with them and rode on into Houston, and I got on home from there to ride it. I was a town drunk for 3 years. Small town, everybody wanted to buy me a beer. Everybody knew me. I knew everybody in the town. The war was still going on. We had not whipped the Japanese at this time. And I stayed peeled drunk for months. 3 months hanging on, doing different jobs. They even gave me a job at a little town to be in the post office. Try staying drunk at night and working in a post office full of women. You can't do it. I couldn't hold up. Well, I tell you, it was rough. I quit. Well, there was contractors around, even in a small town. If you was willing to work, they didn't mind if you stopped at noon and took a drink, just as long as you was able to do the job. So I made it. Month after month, staying drunk every night. Whether I got home or not didn't make any difference. Hell, we'd been in laying down sleeping everywhere in the world anyway, so it didn't bother me to sleep anywhere. Just stretch out on the grass, or if I was in a small town, you could always go to a church and find a pew that was padded, and you could sleep like a lamb. That was wonderful, staying drunk. I met it encouraged that I meet this widow woman. She was a French woman from Addyville, Louisiana. Not making fun, or really, I guess we were at that time. We called the French people Coonasses, and that didn't go over too good with some of them. And then, of course, most of them thought it as a joke and accepted it. But anyway, this widow woman took a liking to me for some unknown reason. French woman, they did not frown on people drinking. We went to many a town in Louisiana, and we would drink, and next morning we'd have gumbo for breakfast. Nothing better than gumbo for breakfast when you got a hangover. So, lo and behold, I married that woman. Her daughter was 6 years old at that time. And of course, she's my daughter now. But my wife stood with me, drinking, because I could, at that time, get on a job at work. I decided to break the habit of drinking every night. Of course, the weekends were different. We could always get drunk on the weekends, but it was different then. And I had a family. And a year later, I had more families. So we had to stop and change our lifestyle.
Well, it has been very wonderful sitting and speaking with you today, and I thank you for taking the time to speak with me. And I want to thank you also for your service to our country. Is there anything that you would like to add that I didn't ask?
Well, dedicated to the men behind the barbed wire, that would be nice.